And this also, yeah. Okay, yes, okay, good. So, I will continue the lectures with slides tomorrow, but the organizers told me that it would be good that for the first day of this school, I give some reminders on the Einstein field equation. So, Adam has already used these, considered perturbations on that. So, let's come back a little bit before at a more fundamental level and discuss the derivation of the Einstein field equations from the Einstein-Hilbert action for gravity. You already saw the Einstein-Hilbert action this morning on the slide. So it is composed of a gravitational term, which is integral over some volume of space-time, V. And here is the volume element, which is an invariant, the invariant volume element, which is a scalar with respect to arbitrary change in the coordinate system, arbitrary diffeomorphism in the coordinate system.
Thanks.
And the Lagrangian of Einstein-Hilbert is the scalar curvature. There is a coupling constant, which is sometimes called the Einstein coupling constant in front. Okay. And this is a functional of the metric, the derivative of the metric and the second derivative of the metric. And there is a matter part, which depends on matter fields that I denote by psi m, that are coupled universally to the metric of space-time. Now, to derive the Einstein field equations from that action, we shall, as usual, vary the action with respect to the metric. Holding the variation of the metric fixed at the boundary of the volume defining the action. That is, the metric such we should vary the metric, that is, we should consider a perturbation of the metric, a linear perturbation of the metric. And we shall say that the action should be stationary with respect to arbitrary variations of the metric, such that the variation of the metric at the boundary of the volume should be zero. And the boundary is therefore a three-dimensional surface, which is the boundary of our integration volume in space-time. When we consider a variation like that for the metric, it is very useful and consistent with Adam's lecture this morning to consider that the variation is a tensor field on the background metric, which is an unperturbed metric. And then to use the covariant derivative associated with the background metric, which is G mu nu. So this is the covariant derivative compatible with G mu nu, that is, which obeys the Ricci theorem, that is, the metric is constant with respect to that covariant derivative. To vary the action, we shall use the Palatini formulas. Which I will leave you as an exercise. Maybe I will use the yellow chalk to say that it is an exercise for you to derive this Palatini formula. There are two Palatini formula. The first Palatini formula is that the Christoffel symbol will vary and that the variation of the Christoffel symbol will be a tensor propagating with respect to this background metric G, and the variation of the Christoffel symbol, again a tensor, is given by a formula actually already given this morning by Adam. I will put like that indices, where I use now the covariant derivative acting on the perturbation of the metric. And there are three terms coming from the three well-known terms of the Christoffel symbol, expressed in terms of the metric, the inverse metric, and the ordinary derivative of the metric. But here you have covariant derivatives. And you have this index, which is summed up in that way. This is exactly the formula written this morning by Adam, except that this morning Adam was considering a full non-linearity expansion. Me, I am considering only a linear perturbation, because this is sufficient to obtain the variation of the action at linear order. And therefore, here I have the metric itself, not the metric plus the perturbation, because this is at linear order in the perturbation. This morning, Adam had a tilde there to say that this is a full metric, valid at, so it was more general. So this is the first Palatini formula, and the second Palatini formula gives of the Ricci tensor, and I will not write the variation of the Riemann tensor. Only the Ricci tensor is useful for the derivation of the Einstein field equations, which is given by, again, two terms acting on the variation of the Christoffel, on the Christoffel symbol. Like that, so we have to put correctly the indices. Mu, rho, rho. Rho, mu, so it should be, sorry, mu, with that indices, sorry, rho, rho. So I leave you that as an exercise to prove these formulas for yourself and or maybe for the session on the exercise tomorrow or a day after. So with this formula, we can vary the Einstein-Hilbert term. We shall write that the variation of square root of minus g r will be given by delta of square root of minus g g mu r mu nu, plus a term which involves the variation of the Ricci tensor that we shall use in that with that formula, plus square root of minus g g mu nu delta r mu. G is the determinant of the covariant component of the metric, and by varying the determinant, we have the well-known formula which involves the cofactors of each of the coefficients of the matrix and the variation gives you that delta G is G mu nu, the inverse metric, multiplied by the variation of the coefficient of the matrix. And so from that, you get that square delta of square root of minus G is square root of minus G over 2, G mu nu, delta G mu nu. I think this is familiar to all of you, so we get the variation of square root of minus G R is given by square root of minus G delta G mu nu coming from the variation of this factor multiplied by R mu nu. But there is also a term coming from the variation of the square root of minus G, which appears absolutely crucial for having a volume element, which is a scalar. And this adds another term with which you recognize the Einstein tensor, which I am calling now G mu nu. And there is an extra term, which is this one. And this one, we can use the second Palatini formula to express it as the covariant divergence of a vector field. And this vector field is immediately given by that expression. So there are the two terms. One is the variation of the Christoffel symbol contracted by the metric, and there is another term, which is coming from this one, where you have the variation of the Christoffel symbol with two indices contracted like that. From Palatini 2, but we have also the Palatini 1, formula. And if we replace now the variation of the Christoffel symbol using the Palatini 1 formula, we get that this vector field is given by, and I will lower the index to be more convenient for me for what I want to say after that. This will be the divergence of a tensor which is made by the linear perturbation of the metric minus G mu nu G rho sigma delta G rho sigma. Okay, so now the variation of my action will be delta S is the integral over the volume V of G4X square root of minus G. I will have delta G mu nu times the Einstein tensor, which comes from here, plus a term, which is the divergence of the vector field and which is a surface term that I will write separately. And I will write actually directly in terms, in a form where we see appearing the usual Einstein field equation, G mu nu minus 8 pi G over C4, G mu nu, where I have introduced the stress energy tensor of the matter, which is the functional derivative of the matter action with respect to the metric. This is a general definition, as you know, valid for any matter fields, particles, fluids, electromagnetic field, and any type of matter, including actually full model, standard model of particle physics. So when I vary the action, I will write that chi mu nu, I define chi mu nu to be 2 over square root of minus g, delta s m over delta g mu nu. So that when I vary the matter action, this is given as an integral over the invariant volume element times t mu nu times g delta g mu nu. So this is the term that I have written here. All that is standard. You will find it in any book of general relativity, any elementary books of general relativity. And from that, you will say, okay, I vary my action. I say that dc should be zero, the variation for any variation of the metric. And this gives me the Einstein field equation that should be zero. And I have my Einstein field equations. But the point I want to make here is that we have also to consider the contribution of this term, which gives you a surface term in the variation of the action. And this is less well known, I would say, and I would like to derive this term properly for you. So this term, so I am now adding it, will be C3 over 16 pi j, the integral over the volume V, d for x square root of minus g, g mu of v mu. And you can rewrite this as being an ordinary derivative, an ordinary divergence of square root of minus vg. And therefore, this is a standard formula that probably you have all seen already. For any vector, this is valid for any vector. The divergence of a vector is 1 over square root of minus g, the ordinary divergence, a surface term. If I am using the Gauss theorem, I transform this term into an integral over the boundary of my volume, sigma, on which I have imposed the variation of the metric to be zero. Exactly. But notice that I have not imposed that the variation of the derivative of the variation of the metric should be zero, because this is contrary to the general recipe for obtaining Lagrange equation from an action. I just impose that the metric should be zero on the boundary. Generally, in many textbooks, we say, okay, the variation, the gradient of the variation of the metric should also be zero on the boundary. Or let us impose that for simplicity, and therefore, I get rid of this term. I don't want to do that. I just impose that the variation of the metric, and not its gradient, not necessarily its gradient, is zero. So I will write this term as just an integral over the boundary sigma of a surface element sigma d sigma mu over the boundary times v mu. And I have still. So we have our spacetime, four-dimensional manifold. We choose an initial volume in spacetime, V. And we have our boundary, sigma. Sigma will be made of parts that are space-like and parts that are time-like. So I will have the situation that here, say I have a space-like three-dimensional surface, and here as well. And here I will have a time-like boundary. The normal vector to the surface will be here a time-like vector, d sigma mu. That I am going to write as n mu, a unit vector perpendicular to the surface times a surface element. And this surface element will be something like dt, d3x, that will be a volume, an ordinary volume surface element. And the vector n mu will be time-like because the surface is space-like. On the other hand, here I will have my normal element, sigma mu, which will be n mu d sigma. And now my surface is time-like, therefore the vector is space-like. And this d sigma will be something like dt, and now an integration, volume integration over a two-dimensional surface, essentially. Here the vector is time-like, so it will obey the normalization condition nu will be minus one for a time-like vector, but here it will obey the normalization g mu nu and mu and nu is plus one for a space-like vector. And like this morning, I just mentioned that this morning for the initial value problem in general relativity, we can associate to the boundary the induced metric on the boundary on sigma, which is actually the projector on that surface, which will project any vector or any tensor down to the surface, orthogonally to the unit vector, orthogonal to the surface. So I will have gamma mu nu is g mu nu plus n mu n nu for the space-like part of the surface. And gamma mu nu would be g mu minus n mu for the space-like, time-like part of sigma. In any case, this gamma is a projector . It satisfies the ordinary relation of projectors, that is the square of that projector is the projector itself. Okay, so let me write it with indices. It should be more clear. Gamma nu nu gamma nu rho will be gamma mu rho. So I will do some calculation to trying to rewrite that surface term into a more convenient form. We have to compute that surface term, and now I introduce the normal. So this is given by the factor in front, d sigma n mu v mu on sigma. So let me evaluate n mu scalar v mu using that expression for the vector, which comes from the two Palatini formulas. N mu, v mu. So I use that formula. So it will be n mu, gradient mu of delta g mu nu minus g mu g rho sigma delta g rho sigma. That I am allowed to rewrite as n mu. So n mu g mu rho covariant derivative rho delta g mu nu. So this term is obviously the first one. I have just lowered the index rho with the metric. And the second term is minus the covariant derivative with respect to the index mu, which is the same as the index mu on the unit vector in front, delta g mu rho. And this term is exactly the second term. You see that here is the metric. I can put the metric outside the covariant derivative. Therefore, it will lower the index on n, n mu, which will then be contracted with the covariant derivative here. And so we recover, indeed, n mu contracted with covariant derivative with respect to the index mu. And further, we notice that this quantity is antisymmetric in rho, in the exchange rho mu. If you change rho and mu, you will recover minus this term, so it is antisymmetric with respect to rho and mu. This is to say that I am allowed to replace here the metric here by the projector, because the projector on the surface will involve n mu and nu. So the extra term that I am adding will be n mu and rho, and n mu, this will be zero by the antisymmetry of this factor. So I rewrite that as n mu gamma mu rho multiplied by del rho delta g mu nu minus mu delta g mu rho. Where I remind you that now the projector is the metric and plus or minus n mu, sorry, n mu and rho, where the plus or minus depend on whether we are on the time-like or space-like part of the boundary. Okay? Now, since we are on the boundary, where the variation of the metric, which is a tensor, is zero. So let me write the boundary here. I have sigma here. I will have, and I have my unit vector n mu, perpendicular to the boundary. And at any point in the boundary, I have delta g mu nu is equal to zero. So if I consider two points, you see, delta g mu nu should be zero at these two points. But I can also consider g mu nu as the second point and expand it in the vicinity of the first point, okay, and say that actually the difference between the two points should always be zero. What I am saying is that if I consider the variation of the metric at point Q, which is zero with our assumption, it should be the variation of the metric at point P, which is also zero. But if I am thinking that I am doing a Taylor expansion of point Q near point P, I will have an extra term. And this extra term will be composed of the difference of coordinates between point P and Q. Say lambda times the derivative with respect to the coordinates lambda. I made a Taylor expansion, so in a usual form, because I am assuming that I have a local inertial frame, assuming that I work, so I have, assuming that I choose a local inertial frame, so that the covariant derivative reduces to ordinary derivative. Because in that frame, the Christoffel symbols are zero, the derivative of the metric are zero, and Adam this morning used these particularly convenient particular frames, and I am using that in writing a Taylor expansion in the usual form. The derivative of the metric is zero, the Christoffel symbol is zero in that frame, but of course, the second derivative of the metric is not zero, this would be curvature, the derivative of the Christoffel symbol is not zero. So here is the term that we get. Since this is zero, and this is zero by our assumptions, we get a relation on the derivative of the metric. So you see, we started with no assumption on the derivative of the variation, but nevertheless, there is a component of the derivative of the variation which will be zero. And this component is easily obtained from that. This should be zero. This is valid in a local inertial frame. On the other hand, we have to look at a tensor which reduces to that expression in a local inertial frame. And if this is a tensor, then it should be valid in any coordinate system. So this vector, you see, this is very easy to find. We can imagine that we have a vector here which is outside the surface. Inside the vector, inside the surface, there will be the projection of that vector perpendicular to that surface, and this should be the vector which is projected from A, so it will be A gamma mu nu A nu, because this induced metric is the projector on the surface. And so the constraint that we have is that the projection of that onto the surface should be zero. And when you have discovered that, you will find that it is absolutely trivial, actually, and you have that in any frame. In any frame, we have that the projection gamma rho sigma sigma delta g mu nu should be zero. So this is a consequence of that relation, and thinking of it, we see that this is immediate, that the projection of the variation of delta g mu nu, since it is zero at any point, this projection on the surface is itself zero. Using that, we can remove one of the terms, namely this one, and we find that n mu p mu is only the second term, minus n mu gamma mu rho mu delta g mu rho on sigma. Okay, that's a formula, but the aim of the calculation was to rewrite this surface term into a more understandable form. And remember that this morning I told you that when we have a surface, there are two tensors that are that describe this surface. One is the metric on that surface, and the other one is the extrinsic curvature. The extrinsic curvature I told you this morning that this is equal to the Lie derivative with respect in the direction n perpendicular to the surface of the induced metric. But there are other forms of the extrinsic curvature that I will not prove for you, but I can give it to you, which will be which will be gamma mu n mu rho rho, and maybe I will add some yellow to say for you that this is an exercise for you to derive this form, which is a projection. So we have two indices, mu nu, with respect to mu, multiplied by the gradient of the unit vector perpendicular, n nu. And in the exercise, you can derive this formula, okay, and justify that actually this formula is symmetric in mu and nu. So the exercise is also that you should show that k mu nu is symmetric in mu nu, which is not obvious from that writing, but actually it is symmetric. And using the extrinsic curvature, which has a very precise meaning for the that the curvature of the surface as seen from an observer sitting outside in the four-dimensional manifold, you can relate now this term to the extrinsic curvature, and actually this is given by
minus 2 of the variation of the extrinsic curvature, and actually the trace of the extrinsic curvature. K is equal to gamma mu nu, K mu nu, trace of extrinsic curvature of sigma. So finally, I will write that here this term is given by minus 2, which is this one. Still the factor in front says by G. Okay, and that will be delta of the integral over sigma of d sigma times this extrinsic curvature.
And so you see that in order to
the Einstein field equation, actually, and if you are starting from a finite volume V, you have to include that term actually in the definition of the action. So,
definition of
the action of GR should include this term. This term. And if you pose S prime, which would be my original action plus C cube over 8 pi G, integral d sigma k, then variation of S prime with respect to the metric would imply the Einstein field equation. That is, G mu nu is equal to 8 pi G over C4 T mu nu. Okay. Do I have some time? Ah, okay. Okay, I prefer that because I have some to tell you today.
So, that was my point for this derivation, is that this surface term is generally forgotten in many books, but this is actually important, and there are several applications of this term for various topics that I will not discuss that today.
Okay, so now that we have the Einstein field equations, I wanted for the last part of the lecture to discuss some particular matter fields for the right-hand side of the Einstein field equations that are useful for gravitational waves. So the matter fields, are entirely described by the stress-energy tensor. The stress-energy tensor is the variation of the matter action with respect to the metric. Notice that the T mu nu, which comes from the variation of the action with respect to the metric, is automatically symmetric in mu and nu, because the metric is symmetric. And this is a general prescription for obtaining the stress energy tensor of any matter field, again. It gives you directly a prescription which is symmetric in mu and mu. Sometimes we can from a Lagrangian for the matter field. We can vary the Lagrangian using the equations of motion, and we may find sometimes, notably for electromagnetic field, U1 fields or gauge field and so on, you may find that the stress energy tensor, which is conserved, I forgot to tell this is a consequence of the Einstein field equation, is not symmetric, but it is always possible to symmetrize the stress energy tensor, and in the end, you will recognize that it is nothing but that the variation of the matter action with respect to the metric. So the first matter fields that we consider are just point particles. So the matter action of point particles is very well known. So I suppose that I have point particles, A, B, say N point particles. I assume that these particles have no interaction. Each of these particles will be described by some four velocity. The parameter along each of the particles will be the proper time of the particle, and the matter action will be the sum over all the particles of the integral of the proper time along the trajectory from minus infinity up to plus infinity of the proper time, dito A. And in front, I have the mass of the particle. And there is a minus sign, which is generally chosen to get the matter action, which is an integral from minus infinity up to plus infinity of minus the metric, g mu nu A, d y a, so y a is the position of my particle, this is the standard action for n particles in given background g mu, the metric is evaluated at the location of the particle. So if this action, I give it to you as an exercise to show compute the T mu nu of that matter by so derivative with respect to the metric. Compute the motion, compute the equation of motion. Okay, and check that it should be the geodesic equation. Okay. Now, what I wanted to tell is that this matter action for n particles without interactions can be rewritten using Eulerian variables, which will be convenient for fluids. And fluids are very important in post-Newtonian approximation, so I'd like to describe this for you. So, yes. The Yes, completely. Ah, yes. The question was that, is this S prime invariant under general diffeomorphism, general coordinate transformation? Yes, this is a scalar. Yes, yeah. Indeed, the n direction, if you vary the metric, the n realization of the n should vary. The metric is zero on the boundary. So the vector is fixed. So it's a general scalar. Okay, so let me now consider point particles, but considered as fluids. So I will consider a fluid of particles. I will use Eulerian type notations for this fluid of particles, which are still without interactions. So I will introduce coordinate velocity, which is not the four velocity. This is VA mu, which will be dy A mu over time t, and time t is the coordinate time, which is yy0 over c. Let me introduce also the density of the particle, as a sum of Dirac delta functions of the particles. I will put here a star to remember this is a coordinate density depending on the coordinate system. Density of particles. This is defined as a sum over the particles of their mass. Times delta Dirac at the location of each of the particles. And this is a function of x and t. X, which is there, t, which is here. From that definition, you find that this density of particles based the usual Eulerian looking or Newton looking continuity equation. Where I have introduced the Eulerian velocity field, usual continuity equation, where I have introduced the Eulerian velocity field, which is a function of x and t, such that this function evaluated at the location of the particle a and at time t is actually my coordinate velocity that I have from here. From these relations, I can also introduce a current, which will be still a coordinate current, depending on the coordinate system, by using g mu, which would be equal to rho star v mu. And this current, using that, will be conserved in the ordinary way. and I can rewrite this equation in a fully covariant way by introducing a vector, g mu, which will be conserved. And this j mu is just square root of minus g, where I am using exactly the same formula, that the divergence of a vector can be written as 1 over square root minus g determinant times the ordinary derivative of the square root of minus g times g star. And so with all these notations, now I can rewrite my action for matter fields, for particles without interaction, into a fluid form, Eulerian form. So action of fluid without interactions is given by SM matter, and this now be written as a fluid action, that is integral over d4x square root of minus g times the scalar density of the particles. And the scalar density of the particle follows directly from here. Rho is given by square root of minus g rho star, actually we have rho is equal to rho star u not divided by, so, okay. This should be given by square root of minus g rho star v mu. And this coordinate velocity is given by square root of minus g rho star the four velocity u mu divided by u naught. U naught will be the usual gamma factor, which is given by that expression. And so here, the scalar density of which is conserved, rho u mu, is zero. And it is related to that coordinate density by rho is square root of minus g rho star u naught. This is the proper density of particles. That is, this is the density of particle in the frame which is at rest with respect to the particle. This is a scalar. It is a number at any point in space-time, while the coordinate density is the number of particles in some volume of unit length of my coordinate system. It is not a scalar. It depends on the coordinate system. And as an exercise, you can derive, again, the T mu nu in fluid form for that matter and the equation of motion. And if I have still 5 minutes, okay. 10 minutes, okay, that's very good. I will come to what I wanted to come, that is the description of relativistic fluids
in GR, which is very important in post-Newtonian theory. And I will introduce these relativistic fluids exactly in that way, by showing the action and deriving the equations of motion from the action. So I will consider the case now of a perfect fluid. This fluid will be described by some proper energy density that is the energy of fluid in a frame where the particle is at rest, which is the meaning of the name proper. This fluid will have some pressure. There will be some internal energy, which is generated by because of that pressure, or that internal energy will be responsible for the pressure inside the fluid. So capital pi will be the specific, that is per unit mass, internal energy of the fluid. I will have also the proper conserved energy, satisfying the conservation law as before for these particles. Rho u mu is zero. Again, this will be the number of baryons which is conserved in each element of the fluid as obtained as measured in the rest frame of the particles, or the fluid at that point. There will be the temperature of the fluid. There will be S, which will be the specific entropy of the fluid. Of the fluid, and again, specific means per unit mass, that is the entropy divided by the mass. And I will introduce also the specific enthalpy of the fluid. And the specific enthalpy of the fluid is just expressed in terms of the internal density, sorry, internal energy density plus P over rho. You recover the standard formula for the enthalpy, which is pi, and actually my pi is the same as the usual U, capital U in thermodynamics, except that pi is u divided by the mass, per unit mass. This is a specific internal energy. Pi will be the internal energy divided by the mass. The volume will be the mass divided by the conserved energy density. So these are the usual variables in thermodynamics. And the entropy of the fluid will be M times the specific entropy that I have introduced. All these are scalars. All are scalar variables. They are the same in any coordinate system. So we have, they are linked by the thermodynamic relation, the first law, which is the law of conservation of energy. Donc, first law of thermodynamics. This is a du is T dF plus P dV, the volume, okay? This is due to the change in the heat to the system, the delta Q, usual delta Q of thermodynamics, and using these variables, pi, rho, and S, we obtain that the variation of G of the internal energy is given by T dS minus P d of 1 over rho. Note that I am using a perfect fluid. I have, for a perfect fluid, I have no heat flow. Okay, and this will be isentropic and no viscosity. This thermodynamic relation can be rewritten in a different way as the variation of the total energy. And I have forgotten to tell you that the total energy will be the sum of the baryons energy, which is conserved, say, plus the contribution from the internal energy by epsilon, which will be rho multiplied by 1 plus pi. And you can rewrite the thermodynamic relation in this form using the definition of the enthalpy is over there, as d epsilon is h d rho plus rho t ds. So here is the baryons, if you like. I am assuming that the number of baryons is conserved in my fluid, and here is the internal energy. The independent degrees of freedom of my fluid, of the perfect fluid, are the conserved current, G mu, which is rho u mu. And the specific entropy. The stress energy tensor of my fluid will be the usual expression for the stress energy tensor of a perfect fluid, u mu, u nu, plus p g mu nu for that fluid, for a perfect fluid. You see that I have no heat flow, for instance, in this, and there are no viscosity in this stress energy tensor. And by writing the equations of motion of my fluid, I give you that as another exercise, if you like, is that these equations are composed of an equation which is the conservation of entropy along the fluid lines. The fluid is isentropic in this way, in this sense. And on the other hand, I have a relativistic Euler equation which tells you that the acceleration of the fluid, of each cell in the fluid, is given by that formula. Euler equation, or generalization of the Euler equation for the fluid. But if I have 3 minutes left, one and a half, I will go very quickly to tell you something interesting about these relativistic fluids, because again, they are presented in usual books in the form that I have written here on the right, namely the conservation of entropy and the acceleration of the fluid, which gives you, tells you that the acceleration is not zero, therefore the fluid is not geodesic because of the pressure, internal, the internal energy, and so on. But actually, these equations can be rewritten in a much better way by introducing the enthalpy current, namely h u mu, enthalpy current, where the enthalpy is given by here. And the equation takes just a very simple form using ordinary derivative, because covariant derivative, the Christoffel symbols cancel out from the equations between that. So this is completely covariant, but we have only covariant derivative, which is very useful, for instance, for numerical simulation of star interiors and so on, neutron stars, and so on, which is given by mu s. Very useful form, which is completely equivalent to the equations of motion which is there. And finally, I can, since I started from the action, I would like that you look at the action of the fluid that I have, I will write it for you, and try to understand all these equations using the action. The action for the fluid, for the matter fluid, for this fluid, is exactly the same as this action, except that, quite naturally, the conserved baryon density is replaced by the total energy density of the fluid. So the action is just minus d for x, square root of minus g, epsilon. And it is maybe a non-trivial exercise if you have not seen it that before. So derive the chi mu nu for that fluid, the perfect fluid, from that action. And find the equations of motion by varying the action with respect to the degrees of freedom of the fluid. And I told you that the degrees of freedom of the fluid are the conserved current and the specific entropy of the fluid. Okay. So you will have to find the equivalent of the Lagrange equation, Euler-Lagrange equation, but written in terms of these variables. And these variables are constrained variables because the current is conserved. So it is non-trivial task, and I can help you if you like to find that. So the exercise is to find the equations of motion by varying the fluid action with respect to the fluid degrees of freedom, that is to G mu nu and the specific entropy. Okay, that would be okay for today. Okay.
Thank you.
No questions. So don't hesitate to ask me for the exercise that I propose if you have any problems, that I am here to help you.
So let me remind you, there is a room on the first floor. I saw somebody who already used it. There are tables and plugs and Wi-Fi. So here we are at the fourth floor. At the first floor, where the library is, there is a big room with tables. You can freely sit there and work together to solve the exercises, or work individually as you prefer. So today we have, okay, now we have the break. We reconvene at 15 past, and then we have the last lecture of today, and then we stay here for roughly 1 hour more for a wild discussion section. So whatever doubts you may have. And then maybe from tomorrow we have more organized exercise solving session. Okay, so we split for the break.